in a new month of February, which means we have a new trait of success. So everybody should have got a card when you came in this morning. We are going to be looking at the traits of self-control and moderation through the month of February. Let me just tell you what that means. It means this: preventing your anything in your life from controlling you and or hindering you from having a clear state of mind. So that's kind of the theme we're going to be talking about through the month of February to help us develop in our spiritual lives that will lead to success both spiritually and personally in our lives. On the back side, you get a little bit more description on that stuff. We'd encourage you to read. And you also get your scriptures. As I tell you every month, is just take these scriptures. I would highly encourage you at least on a daily basis read one of those scriptures. And this gives you something to focus your devotions on. And it puts us all on the same page as a church for a full month. If you have children, it's just something convenient. You can take the maybe read one of the verses to your kids before bedtime or something. It gives you a way to talk about your relationship with Christ with them and help lead them, as we talked about last week, as parents, leading them spiritually. So that's what that is there. This is a resource for you, a devotion card. So take that. There will be more out on the table. That will be out there all month. So if you can pick up extra, put it somewhere where it reminds you during the week. So you just don't do church when you're here. You're actually the church out in the world every day of your life. All right? With that said, today, we're going to start off talking about slavery, both physically and spiritually. Now, when I talk about the word slavery, thank you, DeMarcus. I appreciate you helping me out there. All right. As we talk about slavery, it's something we tend to think of in the past, but the thing is, it is very prevalent in our world, and you will be incredibly shocked how prevalent it is in the modern world. So what I have is kind of just like a slide presentation I'm going to walk through with Chuck here, giving you some information about the slave trade. Human trafficking is what it's called in modern times, and just kind of giving you some pictures to put some faces with it and what's going on in our world. So Chuck, give me the first slide here. Okay, human trafficking in the world. There's 14.2 million victims of forced labor worldwide, which would be more what we view as traditional slaves. People have no rights. They're owned by people 14.2 worldwide that are forced labored slaves right here. And you can kind of see the type of work they do. A lot of them work in the fishing industry, and a lot of them work in just low-end physical labor type jobs. All right? Next slide. There are 4.5 million victims of sex trafficking worldwide, which is one you probably hear about more on the news and stuff like that, is the sex trafficking trade worldwide, but 4.5 victims of that. You just get some pictures of kind of what that looks like and what their lives are like on a daily basis. Next one. 55% of slaves in the world are female, 45% of the slaves in the world are male. Many of your slaves work in the areas like these, doing sewing and things like that, work up to 18 hours a day for up to maybe 25 cents to 35 cents per hour. That's what they're making at these jobs. And it's just enough for them to get some food and all, but they really have no freedom. They can't go away. They can't go anywhere because they've been trafficked, and I'll explain how all that works a little bit later. Next slide. This kind of gives you regional figures of where most of those slaves are in the world right now. As you can see over here in Southern Asia area is the highest number population-wise, which is 11.7 million. A lot of those are in like Pakistan because you have the huge population bases there in Southern Asia area. 11.7, the other huge area, and the highest percentage is actually in Africa, where there's about 3.7 million slaves. So that is the highest percentage area. In the United States and Western Europe, there's about 1.5 million between North America and Western Europe that are actually slaves. Most of those that work in those areas are in the sex trafficking area, not in the labor area. All right? You can see Southern America, you get kind of just a rundown of where most of those slaves are. Let me go to the next one. Between 14,000 and 17,000 people are trafficked into the U.S. per year. So if you think it's not something that happens in the United States of America, it definitely is. Between 14,000 to 17,000 get trafficked across our borders per year that are brought into our country and are actually what we would consider slaves in our nation right now. Next one. California harbors the top three child sex trafficking cities in the United States. The most prevalent area is Los Angeles, number two is San Francisco, and number three is San Diego. So if you're in those cities, you're very likely to encounter or at least see people who you would consider considered in the sex trafficking that are slaves in those cities. Next one, there are 153 million victims, 5 to 14-year-olds, of child labor worldwide. So not adults. The first part I talked about was basically mostly adults. When you get into this area, this is between 5 and 14-year-olds. What they consider to be child labor is kids that are working over 12 hours a day doing physical labor. So 153 million, okay, children are in child labor worldwide. Next slide. 97% of them are willfully forced into labor by their parents. So their parents send them off to these places to work between anywhere 12 to 18 hour days doing work to bring some money into the families, and they send them off to it. You can just kind of see the type of work. It's just unreal. Go to the next one. Child labor, this is astonishing. Child labor makes up 32% of Africa's workforce. A third of the African workforce is child labor. 22% of Asia's workforce and 17% of Latin America's workforce. Those are amazing numbers when you think about them. All right, these little kids here break my heart. Because those kids can't be, what, 4, 5 years old at most? Okay, they might be a little bit older because they're probably malnourished and stuff, so they might look a little younger than they are, but just that girl there, she pounds rocks. That's some of the jobs they do, is they break down rocks. Okay, go to the next one. The average value of a slave in 2015, $90. Okay, the average value of a human being who's in the trafficking and modern-day slavery, $90. To give you a comparison, if they do inflation, back in the slave trade with the United States back in the 1800s of Africa, the typical slave that was brought into the United States was paid over $40,000 per slave. Okay? Now it's $90. That just gives you an idea of how cheap slave labor has gotten, and how in the modern world we think it's gone and we think it's something that has been abolished. It's not. It's incredibly prevalent. Go to the next one. Okay, when you watch these photos, if you're like me, you probably felt some things, right? Here's some of the things I went through as I was going through this, and I had to research this week to get these stats on. As you research it and see more and more photos, it's heartbreaking. It's heartbreaking. So the best way I can describe some of the feelings that went through my head was sadness. Again, heartbroken. One of the other things that comes to my mind is just anger. Like, you just wish I could find the people and traffic them, and I know as a minister I'm supposed to be peace-loving and I'm not supposed to have those thoughts. But in all honesty, man, if I could find that time with one of those guys and give me 10 minutes in a room and give me someone I can fight, so maybe Shane or Steven or something. I don't know how much damage I'm going to do, but Julian, you come with me?
1 minute.
Okay, 1 minute. Give you an idea, just relevant stuff. You saw this week in that trial, the doctor of the U.S. gymnastics. How many of you saw this, the father this week? Where his thing was, I just want 5 minutes with him, Judge. Give me just 5 minutes. And the judge denied it, and he basically lunged at the guy. That's kind of how I feel when you see this stuff, especially with the child labor stuff. And there's a lot of pictures you just can't show in there because you do this research, you just start going, oh my gosh, I just can't show that on the screen at church because that's just too much. So I showed you mild examples of it. But what the other thing it causes me to do is this, I want to do something about it. I hate just seeing it and not want to do something about it. So I thought I'd give you a resource. That's something you would like to help out with how prevalent it is in our world today. This is an organization I found that has good reviews. I kind of know some people who work with it, so I know it has high integrity. Most of your money goes directly to doing the work they do. It's called Rafa House. What they actually do, they are out of Joplin, Missouri, just across the border. And what they actually do is they rescue sex trafficked kids. They started in Cambodia, and now they have reached several other countries, but they give safe houses. So what they do is they go and they actually rescue kids, put them in these safe houses where they can't be found, and then love them and kind of reintroduce them to kind human interaction again and try to restore their lives. So they're an incredible organization. If it's something you would like to donate to or something like that, you have it on the front of your program there. It's called RafaHouseIThink.org. You can go to, and there's different ways you can help them through contributions or prayer or different things like that. I'd encourage you to maybe go check that out if you want to do something. But usually when we see modern slavery, when we see trafficking of human beings, it causes anger in us. And what I want to do at this point, though, is this. And I want to help us to start thinking not just of physical world slavery at this point, but spiritual world slavery. And I'm going to read to you from Romans chapter 6. The Apostle Paul, he says this. He says, "Don't you realize you become the slave of whatever you choose to obey?" Okay, let me read that again. "Don't you realize that you become a slave of whatever you choose to obey? You can be a slave to sin, which leads to death, or you can choose to obey God, which leads to righteous living." Here's what's sad, all right? As much as those pictures affect us that we see and on that screen and we hear those sets, as much as that causes anger in us and affects us, the real truth is this. When it comes to our own selves and looking at the spiritual slavery we find ourselves in, we have mostly become comfortably numb to it. We have accepted it as a norm in our lives, and we have accepted sins that ravage us that just are just, that's just common. It's just who I am now. It's just part of my life. And we stop getting angry at it. We stop having an emotional response to it and an anger going, why do I allow that in my life? Why do I allow that to enslave me in my life? It's a lot easier to see it on the screen and see it in other people and get angry. It's a lot harder to look at our own selves and go, why do I allow myself to be enslaved by these different sins? In 1 Corinthians, Paul writes this in chapter 6, verse 12. He says, "You say, I'm allowed to do anything." And that's what we say. I'm allowed to do anything. I have free will. I have the right to do anything. He says, "But not everything is good for you." And he says, "And even though I'm allowed to do anything, I must not become a slave to anything." Paul was very concerned about becoming a slave to anything, having anything that dominated his life outside of his walk with Jesus Christ. And he was very concerned about that. Romans 8, 6, he writes this. "So letting your simple nature control your mind leads to what? Death." And he says, "But letting the Spirit control your mind leads to life and peace." So today what I want to do is help us identify the things in our lives that tend to enslave us. And the cool thing about the scriptures is there's a passage over in Galatians chapter 5. You've probably heard it before if you've been in church. But it's a really good checkbox thing to look at and go, how much am I enslaved? How much has sin really gained a foothold in my life? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to read through this passage in Galatians 5, 19 through 23. You're going to see checkboxes come up that kind of give you the different bullet items in this passage. And then I'll go back and kind of review it with you here a little bit. But here's what it says starting in verse 19. It says this. There's the list. It says, "When you follow the desires of your sinful nature, the results are very clear. Sexual immorality, impurity, lustful pleasures, idolatry, sorcery, hostility, quarreling, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambition, dissension, division, envy, drunkenness, wild parties, and other sins like these. Let me tell you again, as I have before, that anyone living that sort of life will not inherit the kingdom of God." Okay, then it goes on and says this. "But the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control." Okay? Looking at these lists that are on the screen, you can get a good idea of how enslaved you are spiritually. All right? So let me just go through some of these things. And what I want you to be thinking about is, does that describe a part of who I am? Is that something I see in my life on a semi-regular basis or a regular basis? And kind of check that box off in your brain. All right, here we go. First one, it says sexual activity outside of marriage. So sexual activity outside of the marriage relationship, that is what sexual impurity means when it talks about in the scriptures. It's any type of sexual relationship out of a husband-wife relationship is called sexual impurity. It's a sin, all right? Next one, lustful pleasures. Obviously, pleasures of the flesh, desiring, usually lust is desiring the flesh of someone else, having a lustful desire for people. Idolatry, which I would say is setting up anything as an authority in your life other than God. All right, that can be people, that can be a pursuit of things, that can be anything else you find security in other than your Lord Jesus Christ. That would be idolatry. Sorcery, I don't think many of us probably struggle with that, I'm not aware of. Anne's given a smirks, so she must dabble in it some. But outside of Anne, I'm not too sure of anyone else with the sorcerer thing. The next one, these were to get a little bit more hostility. And these are my descriptions I put with these because I was trying to figure out how to distinguish some of these from each other. Hostility is this, anger towards others. Is you just walk around with an anger towards other people. That's what hostility would be. Quarreling would be this. It's not just that you have a hostility and you dislike them, there's anger inside you. It's actually you try to start something with them. You try to, as I always like to say, poke the bear. Okay? You like to go poke the bear and get the bear angry, and you like trying to start a fight, alright? Next one, jealousy, which I would describe here as relationship-based, meaning you're jealous of someone else and who they are, and maybe the prestige they have, or the positions they have, or whatever else. You have jealousy, and distinguish that from envy if you go down towards the bottom. That one's not relationship-based, that's more materialistic-based. Okay, so envy is you have something that's materialistic that I wish I had that I could get from you. That's envy. The other one, jealousy is more relationship-based. Outbursts of anger, where you just have a short temper and you say stupid stuff to people in a mean way. The next one, selfish ambition, which is you are self-focused. You walk through your life and you're worried about you and how everything happens to you and what it means to you, and you don't look outside of yourself and you don't think about the needs of others. Dissension would be this, relational group issues. The best way I could describe dissension is you have a hard time working within a group and keeping your mouth shut. When you're in a group, you have to criticize people behind the scenes, you have to gossip, you have to slander, you just have to cause little issues that way and have dissension that I'm just not on board, and you have to do that. The next one would be division, which is a step further within a group. It's not just I make little comments and stuff, I actually start working to divide the group. I start trying to make enemies on sides and divide people and cause divisions. Last one, drunkenness and wild parties. Again, this will go into some of the moderation stuff as we go through this month, but overdoing any with excess of any type of things, it starts to alter your mindset, and things like that, and wild parties, which probably includes half the things on that list, all right? So you should have some things checked off. All of us should have some things on there. Mine, just so you can pick up yours, one of mine tends to be the quarreling. Not with you, I like poking the bear. Okay, so authority figures above me, people who I don't think deserve the authority that they have, and that walk around with, you know, so the people I walk around as if I'm prestigious and I'm all this and I'm up here and you're down. I love poking the bear on those people. It's just, my mother has seen this my whole life. Since I was a child, I liked poking that bear. So it would start off with my parents and my siblings, and then turn to the school people and church people. And yeah, all those, I have a natural affinity to that sin, all right? So that's the one that tempts me the most that I have to work on. There's several others up there I can check off and go, some of these things are in my life from time to time and I need to work on. On the freedom in Christ side, you have these, love. Do you actually love people? Not talking about your spouse and your kids. You naturally gonna love them, anybody can love them. I'm talking about your enemies. Okay, I'm talking about people you don't particularly care for. Can you look past their issues and still learn to love them? Joy. Do you walk around in your life and sense a sense of joy on a regular basis where you have an internal joy in you that can't be affected by the things in this world or the people around you? It's just a joy that you have because you know you are a child of God. And that brings a warming, whatever you want to say, to your heart. It's just something that you know is there that you have this internal joy. Peace. Do you have peace between you and your relationship with God? Is it something you don't struggle with? Is it something you go, I know I'm right with God, not that I'm perfect, but I'm right with God and I have peace about that relationship. Patience. Are you patient with people? Okay? Can you step back? Again, put people's issues aside to have patience with them to go, I can still work with you and I'm not just going to lash out at you because you offended me here and there. Next one, kindness. Are you kind to people? Do you look to be kind to people? We were talking about this in Sunday school class. When you're out in public, do you try to give someone a smile? Do you try to uplift their spirits? Do you do kind little things? Do you open doors for them? Do you do kind acts to the people around you? Goodness. Do you do good things? Do you seek to do good things? Is that a desire that's constantly in your heart? faithfulness. Faithfulness to the teachings of Christ. Faithfulness to the promise of the Holy Spirit. When the Spirit prods you, when you read the scriptures, are you faithful to those things you see? Gentleness would be this. Gentleness. How would you describe gentleness? Stephen Letterman. No. Okay, no. Gentleness would be someone that you don't feel tentative with, I guess is the best way. You don't feel worried about going to interact with them or whatever. You know when you don't interact with them that you're going to feel good about it. That would be the best one I can think of is gentleness. Like, it's not Stephen. No, that's not Stephen. All right, and the last one, self-control, which is we're going to be spending a lot of time this month on this one. Can you control yourself from doing what you know you shouldn't and doing what you should do? Can you have control of that in your life? Now, when you look at those lists, you should be able to get a decent idea of how your life is right now, how enslaved you are in any area in your life. Now, what I want to do is this, is I want to go back. I think I missed this. I did. Chuck, can you go back to how human trafficking works? It was before this slide, maybe. Okay, let me walk you through now how human trafficking works. They have a very integral system of how they attain slaves that they then traffic throughout the world. Here's how it works. Number one is that they seduce people with false promises. Typically, how they get slaves is you have a businessman or something goes into poor areas and countries, usually rural areas, and tells parents, here's what I can do for you, is if you give me your kid, I'll take them back to the city. We have a job waiting for them and stuff. We will get them educated. We'll get them a job. They will send you money back. So you'll start earning some money. They will get educated. You will better your life and give your kid a better opportunity in the world. And parents go, here's my child. Take him to the city because it's better than what I can get to. What they do then is this. They isolate them. And the way they isolate them is once they get these kids, they take these kids off. And they usually take them across borders. And this is why it's called human trafficking. Let me tell you why. These children that they get from these homes have no identification and they have no type of ID. So the minute they cross them over borders, they know they can't get back into their home countries because they have no type of ID or anything to identify themselves, and they will be shut down at the borders. So it's called human trafficking because the idea is not to keep the people that you take from their homes in their home countries. It's to take them across country territories, put them in a new country where they have no escape. So you isolate them and they know I can't ever go back home and I have no way to get away from this. Third step is they devalue them. They start making them either do actions or they start physically abusing them in ways that makes the person feel devalued and steals their humanity from them. So they devalue them. Next thing they do is the person at that point typically loses hope, which goes, my old life is gone, this is what I am now, and I have no hope of anything better, and this is just kind of where we're at. And the last thing that happens to individuals that are in human trafficking is they start to accept their new reality because they've lost hope, they're now abused, and basically they just go, all I am is a slave, and they stop attempting to actually find release, they stop attempting to get freedom. They can even have people come tell them, I can help you escape. And you will have, this is one of the problems I had in Rafa House and all that, you will have people in human trafficking in the slave that are slaves that will refuse to leave it because they've just accepted that's who they are now and there's nothing better for them in life. And so to convince them and tell them there is something better, they can't even comprehend it now because they have a new life and a new reality they've just accepted. It's a very serious way of destroying human beings. Now what I want you to do is this. Chuck moves ahead two slides. I want you to understand, Satan works physical slavery the same way he works spiritual slavery. And I want to show you the similarities. Here's how Satan works spiritually on us. And you can see this in your life. You've probably experienced this. This is how he works. The first thing he does is he seduces us with false promises. That's what sin is all about. All right? Satan comes in and he promises you, if you would do things opposite of how God wants you to do these things, you'll get a benefit. And you will better your life. We see this from the very beginning with Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve start off, God says, you have everything, just don't touch this one tree. Don't touch the fruit on that one tree. Everything else is yours. And Satan comes to him and says, what? Are you really going to what? Die? Are you really going to die if you eat that fruit? And Eve even them look at the fruit and it says it looks good, and they think about all the knowledge they can gain and all the benefits they can gain from it, and they go, okay. And they eat from the fruit. And right there, you have it set up. He seduces us with false promises. A saint actually says to him, God just doesn't want you to have all that knowledge. He's trying to kind of hide stuff from you. And so they take it, they eat, and go, okay. And that's how he gets a sin. And if you think about the sin in your life, usually that's how it starts. It's something attractive to you. You know it's probably not right, but it seems to offer benefits until we get into it. And here's the second thing. This one's a little bit different. In human trafficking, physically, the traffickers do this to their slaves. In the spiritual world, typically we do this to ourselves, which is we isolate ourselves from God because of guilt. So we indulge in a sin. Once we get into that sin, we actually have guilt from it because we experience the consequence. We experience the consequences of it, and that leads to guilt in our lives. So at that point, what we typically do, you've all been there, we withdraw from God. Right? That's what I do. At times in my life when I'm in sin, stuff like that, what happens is I know God's aware of the sin I'm doing. I feel guilty about it, and my response is I will pull back from God. And I will isolate myself from God because I'm unworthy to be in His presence now. And that's what guilt typically does. The third thing we see a saint will do then is this. He devalues us with shame. And what he does there is that leads us to being seduced by more false promises. Okay? There is guilt, and then there's shame. Guilt is something that lasts for a moment. Guilt is something each time you indulge in it, you know I'm doing something wrong. Shame is this. Something changes about how I view myself. And I view myself differently now. I don't view myself the way I once did. I don't view myself with the value I once did. Shame is something that devalues you to the point where you just go, I'm not worthy anymore. How many of you at times in your life have ever felt shame? Okay, it's a horrible emotion. It's a destructive thing in our lives. Now, sometimes it can be used for good purposes by God, but it's a horrible thing to go through. But this is the next thing he does, is he brings shame into your life. And when we have shame and we don't have an answer for it, what it does, it makes the promises of the false ones, it makes them much more desirable to us. And what you will see is people get in a snowball. So they commit a sin, they feel guilt, eventually it causes shame, they feel like I have no value anymore, and then the world's promises of this is how you get your value back, they start like this vicious cycle and go back, and they commit a sin again, and more guilt and more shame, and it's this vicious cycle of this. Those I work with, the kids that you work with, is that not true? The vicious cycle of shame, it destroys children. So our counselors that work with them, it is heartbreaking when you see kids, because it's kids that don't even know how to love themselves anymore. And there's a lot of adults that walk around us that never express it, you don't know, that live in shame and don't know how to love themselves anymore and don't think God can ever love them. The fourth thing that leads to is this. Eventually, they lose hope of redemption. So once shame sets in your life, eventually the next step is over time is you just get to a point where you go, God can't love me anymore. I can't be saved. I can't be redeemed. I'm just not capable of God loving me anymore because I'm too bad. I've done too many things. As a minister, I hear this one more than anything else probably. It's God can't forgive me for that one. I did this thing and that one can't be forgiven. Okay? Hear that one all the time. Last step is this. We finally just accept our new reality distant from God. The last thing that happens is after we give up the hope of redemption, we just kind of go, this is just who I am. I'm going to go through life the rest of the way. Now, as Christians, what we tend to do a little bit here is we have little compartments. So we have little areas of our life, not be our whole life that we just accept our new reality and keep distant from God, but a lot of us have areas of our life that we still haven't dealt with God that we put in a little compartment. And that's an area I don't deal with God. And I keep that part of me kind of distant over here so God doesn't see that part of me. But He likes these parts of me, and these parts I do well, but this part I can't ever reveal to Him. And that's not the relationship Christ wants with you. That's not the relationship that Christ desires for you to experience with Him. John 10:10 says this, the thief's purpose, we talked about this last week, is to steal, kill, and destroy. Okay? Physical slavery, spiritual slavery, the goal of it, the thief, Satan's goal is to steal, kill, and destroy you. That's his whole purpose. And then it goes on and says, my purpose, Jesus, is to give them a rich and satisfying life. All right? Jesus wants to free us from our spiritual enslavement. Jesus can restore our hope. He can remove our guilt, and he can repair our shame. Let me say it this way personally to you. I want you to understand this. Jesus can restore your hope, okay? Jesus can remove your guilt, and Jesus can repair your shame. That is what Christ can do in your life. The key to finding the spiritual freedom and continuing to live free is found through learning self-control and practicing moderation. And that's what we're going to be learning about this month. So learning these two traits and then putting them into practice in your life, what happens is you will find freedom and you will find peace and you will prevent yourself from ever becoming a slave again. So through the month of February, we're going to learn how to break free from the things that enslave us and begin to live as free people, as God